Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Trumping Obama, How President Trump Saved Us from Barack Obama's Legacy, by Matt Margolis, foreword by Jeffrey Lord, read by John McLain. Foreword by Jeffrey Lord. America is divided, goes the common phrase of the day. Democrats are so convinced President Donald Trump is an easy mark to beat for re-election in 2020 that the list of would-be nominees is long enough to fill a small airliner. Not so fast. In Trumping Obama, Matt Margolis, author of The Worst President in History, The Legacy of Barack Obama, makes plain, in detail, just why President Trump has been such an effective chief executive, and exactly why the Trump base sticks with him. Running through one Trump policy triumph after another, Margolis illustrates how Donald Trump has set about trumping Obama, which is to say undoing, if not shredding completely, the entire 8 years of the Obama presidential legacy. The story is helped by the Margolis confession that in 2016 he was hardly a Trump enthusiast, and, as with so many, was sadly convinced that all the relentless headlines about the inevitability of a Hillary Clinton victory were accurate. They weren't, in more ways than one. What Matt Margolis contributes in the following is considerable. Thanks to President Donald Trump, he writes, the Obama era, once seen as transformative and consequential, will now be a mere footnote in history. Margolis then proceeds to detail exactly how this has been done. From re-implementing President Ronald Reagan's Mexico City policy that requires foreign non-governmental organizations, NGOs, to agree, as a condition of their receipt of U.S. federal funds, that they would neither perform nor actively promote abortion as a method of family planning in other nations, to other domestic policy items, like reversing the Obama gun grab and open border policies, repealing the craziness of so-called net neutrality, dismantling Obamacare, overturning racial quota policies, rolling back the financial regulatory jungle that was Dodd-Frank regulation, and oh so much more domestically. Margolis has the historical goods. Needless to say, the specifics of Trump's military and foreign policy are examined here as well. From the pullout from the Trans-Pacific Partnership, to reversing the Obama policy towards the Cuban Castro family dictatorship, and, particularly irritating to the left, withdrawing the U.S. from the appallingly dangerous Iran deal, and finally defeating ISIS, the Obama legacy has headed for the historical exits. Or, as Ronald Reagan might say, the ash heap of history. But perhaps no reversal of Obama policy has gotten under the skin of the Obama loyalists and the left in general more than the Trump decision to pull the United States out of the Paris Climate Agreement. Margolis correctly describes the Paris Accord as the pièce de résistance of his, Obama's, environmental legacy. And indeed, it was. Frantic yelps went out from leftist environmentalists that in undoing this particular Obama legacy, Trump, but of course, would destroy the planet and that the United States no longer cared about the environment. To no avail. Trumping Obama further explores a policy-by-policy analysis of just how, and importantly, why, the Obama legacy deserved dismantling. As the 2020 election season arrives, Trumping Obama is the essential handbook for Trump supporters and Trump opponents that will provide a serious reminder of what exactly is at stake and just why so many millions of Americans voted for Trump in the first place. Jeffrey Lord is a former CNN contributor, columnist, and author of Swamp Wars. Introduction. In the fall of 2012, despite polls suggesting otherwise, I was convinced America would not re-elect Barack Obama. Mitt Romney was not my ideal candidate, but he was what America needed, a politician with private sector business experience who could get our economy moving again. I took Romney's defeat very hard. In 2016, I determined not to let my personal political biases cloud my judgment. I wouldn't write off polls and assume they were skewed like many of us assumed back in 2012. I spent the entire 2016 presidential campaign season preparing myself for the Hillary victory that virtually everyone considered a sure thing. The last few months were brutal for me and for most of America's so-called deplorables. Since the aggregates of national and state polling at the time showed Mrs. Clinton cruising to victory, most of Trump's supporters believed his defeat was inevitable. A CNN ORC poll at the end of October showed that nearly 7 out of 10 voters thought Hillary was on the path to victory. 8 years of Obama had been devastating for the country. Would we survive another 4-8 with Hillary at the helm? The outlook seemed bleak. I didn't even like watching the news on television or listening to talk radio in my car. Instead, I'd lose myself in novels just to escape the gloomy future toward which America hurtled. Perhaps I wouldn't have been so glum if I liked the alternative, but I didn't. I was not happy when Donald Trump announced his campaign. Sure, he was a successful businessman, as Romney was, but his style irked me. I didn't see him as a true conservative. I thought it was just an ego-boosting publicity stunt, and winning wasn't a priority. I was not on the Trump train. In fact, for Halloween, mere days before the election, a liberal friend of mine at work suggested I'd dress up as Donald Trump and she'd come as Hillary Clinton. "You mean you're going to dress up in an orange jumpsuit?" I asked. She didn't get it, but she convinced me to go along with her plan anyway. So I bought a Trump wig, wore a suit and a red tie, and walked into the office looking like Donald Trump. My friend couldn't find a Hillary wig and abandoned the plan. So I spent the whole day dressed up as Trump without a Hillary to complete the effect. I was pretty bitter about it. Not just because my friend had not come in dressed as Hillary, meaning I was the only one in costume in the entire office, but because I was still strongly against Trump and did not plan to vote for him. I live in New York State, so who I voted for didn't matter. Hillary would win the state easily. I planned to write in Ted Cruz or skip that ballot question entirely. I couldn't vote for Evan McMullen. It wasn't until the Sunday before the election that I finally got on the Trump train, when, for the second time, former Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI Director James Comey, announced that Hillary would not face charges for her mishandling of classified information with her unsecured private email server. If she got into the White House, she'd have Comey's support as she continued her corrupt and criminal behavior from the Oval Office. She'd make Obama look like a Boy Scout. Not that I didn't already know how filthy the Clinton machine was, but Comey's announcement was the last straw. I still thought Trump had zero chance of winning, so Election Day left me with a pit in my stomach the size of the national debt. But then, something strange happened. As that night progressed, Trump's odds of winning kept getting better and better. Eyes were on Florida as Trump outperformed expectations in key areas where Hispanic turnout was expected to keep the Sunshine State blue. My wife and I watched the proceedings on CNN, and the panel of supposed experts tap danced and practically pleaded with the voters as the votes were tallied. 4 years earlier, Karl Rove criticized the premature declaration of Obama's win in Ohio, and thus the presidency, but now we were witnessing the opposite scenario. CNN's liberal pundits were visibly distraught as Florida, Ohio, Pennsylvania, Iowa, Wisconsin, and Michigan began to look good for Trump. As they called each state, they stared at the map and scrambled to find outlandish alternate pathways for Clinton. At 9 p.m. Eastern Time, Hillary's handlers told her crowd of supporters to go home. She couldn't even bring herself to face her own party. The atmosphere on CNN was like a funeral. It was hilarious. Trump had done it. He saved us from a Hillary Clinton presidency against all odds. For that, I'll always be grateful to him. He still wasn't my preferred candidate, and there were plenty of reasons to question his alleged conservative credentials. He had run on a platform of dismantling the legacy of Barack Obama, and I sincerely hoped he would keep his promises. Many predicted that, once in office, Trump's moderate and liberal tendencies would eclipse the conservative agenda he promised. And, had that happened, I wouldn't be writing this book. The Obama years were a disaster for the United States, but Obama's govern-by-executive-pen approach meant that his legacy could be reversed. If Trump wanted to, he could undo Obama's unconstitutional executive orders, and with the full support of a Republican-controlled House and Senate, he might roll back Obama's few legislative victories. And, believe it or not, he has. Thanks to President Donald Trump, the Obama era, once seen as transformative and consequential, will now be a mere footnote in history. Just 5 months into the Trump presidency, Peter Baker, the chief White House correspondent for the New York Times, wrote, "Rarely has a new president appeared so determined not just to steer the country in a different direction, but to actively dismantle what was established before his arrival." Former Vice President Joe Biden was none too happy about Trump's success erasing Obama's legacy. During an interview with CNN's Chris Cuomo, he called Trump's tenure a disaster and lamented, "All he seems to be trying to do is undo everything that President Obama has done." Perhaps to reassure himself, if not all of Obama's loyal followers, he added, "But he's not able to do that, by the way." Andrew Sullivan, writing in New York Magazine in May 2018, disagreed. He argued Trump had been remarkably successful in reversing Obama's achievements. In 17 months, he has effectively erased Barack Obama's two-term legacy. That Trump has succeeded in doing this is no small thing. The executive director of the Weekly Standard, Fred Barnes, called Trump's success historic. Presidents often vow to wipe out big chunks of their predecessors' legacies. President Eisenhower was going to take on the New Deal. Ronald Reagan targeted the Great Society. Both backed down. Trump, working with congressional Republicans, hasn't. He's eager to deflate Obama's standing and inflate his own. Despite the doubts of never-Trump conservatives and the mainstream media, Obama's legacy is in utter ruins. His executive pen was really a pencil, and Trump was the eraser. I should acknowledge that this book is not a comprehensive collection of all of Trump's achievements. Trump has achieved many positive things that aren't just reversals of Obama-era policies. His decision to move the U.S. Embassy in Israel to Jerusalem was the reversal of a long-standing policy supported by both Democrat and Republican administrations, for example. But, as the author of two other books about Barack Obama, one about his record and one devoted to his scandals, I felt it was important to focus this book only on how Trump saved us from Obama's legacy. Why? Because had Hillary Clinton won in November 2016, Obama's odious agenda would have become impossible to undo by any future Republican president. The 2016 election was our last hope to save this country from an enduring age of leftist overreaching government. Trump may not have been the candidate you wanted, but he's defied the odds and won. Even if you don't like his style or his Twitter habit, this book will show you he was the president we needed. Chapter 1. General Domestic Policy. On October 30th, 2008, candidate Barack Obama told a crowd of his supporters, "We are 5 days away from fundamentally transforming the United States of America." Obama made good on his promise in myriad ways. His changes to domestic policy all increased the government's role in our daily lives and altered the culture. The Obama years saw a dramatic shift in American norms, where what was once unfathomable became federal policy in the name of social justice. Obama saw abortion rights as a sacred right to be enshrined, protected, and federally funded. Once self-evident truths, like men are men and women are women, were now disputed by the federal government. As the joke goes, John F. Kennedy put men on the moon, Barack Obama put men in the women's room. It would be funnier if it weren't true. Religious liberty lost its hallowed place in the halls of government during the Obama years. If you were a religious florist, a baker, or a photographer who offered those services for weddings, the Obama administration compelled you to provide those services for a same-sex wedding, regardless of your beliefs. Paul Kengor, professor of political science and executive director of the Center for Vision and Values at Grove City College, put it best. "That is a fundamental transformation of a culture and a nation that did not exist prior to Barack Obama's ascent." In the Obama era, those who didn't subscribe to the radical reinterpretations of gender and marriage were, Kengor noted, portrayed as the outliers, as abnormal, as extremists, as haters. He added, "If you dissent from this new vociferous breed of human nature redefiners, they sue you, they jail you, they smear you, they boycott you, they harass you, they ruin you, and they do so with no sense of their hypocrisy in the name of tolerance and diversity." While the battle for the culture never ends, Trump has taken it out of the hands of bureaucrats and politicians and put it back in the hands of the American people. They'll decide how they wish to live, not the president or an oppressive government wrapping itself in a rainbow-colored flag. Reinstating the Mexico City policy. Many on the right weren't convinced that Trump would govern as a conservative, let alone as a social conservative. Though he campaigned as a pro-life Republican who promised to defund Planned Parenthood and appoint pro-life justices to the Supreme Court, his past comments suggested he wasn't committed to such policies. He praised Planned Parenthood, saying, "They do great things for women." Pro-life advocacy groups waited to see whether he would keep his promises or govern like a New York liberal. He gave the first clue of how he'd lead on the social issues a few days after he took the oath of office. First implemented by Ronald Reagan in 1984, the Mexico City policy requires foreign non-governmental organizations, NGOs, to agree, as a condition of their receipt of U.S. federal funds, that they would neither perform nor actively promote abortion as a method of family planning in other nations. The policy remained in effect until it was rescinded by Bill Clinton, after which George W. Bush reinstated the policy in 2001. Barack Obama rescinded the policy again when he took office. Despite some doubt, President Trump reinstated the policy on January 23, 2017. "The president, it's no secret, has made it very clear that he's a pro-life president," said Trump's then-spokesman Sean Spicer during his first daily briefing. "He wants to stand up for all Americans, including the unborn, and I think the reinstatement of this policy is not just something that echoes that value, but respects taxpayer funding as well." Restoring race-neutral guidelines for college admissions. In 2011 and 2016, the Obama administration issued guidelines to encourage colleges and universities to use race as a factor in admissions. While race-based admissions claim to be about reversing discrimination and promoting diversity, they also have unintended negative consequences. For example, the students of Fair Admissions sued Harvard University in 2014 on behalf of Asian American students who faced an unfair higher standard to gain access to the Ivy League giant. Despite having higher academic and extracurricular scores than any other racial group, Harvard admissions officers gave Asian American applicants the lowest personal score ranking of any racial group. According to 2013 analysis by Harvard's Office of Institutional Research, if race weren't a factor in the admissions process, Asian Americans would make up a higher percentage of admitted classes each year. In 2017, Trump's Justice Department launched an investigation into Harvard's race-based discrimination. The Department of Justice is committed to protecting all Americans from all forms of illegal race-based discrimination, said Justice Department spokeswoman Sarah Isger Flores. The Trump administration revoked these guidelines, reinstating Bush-era race-neutral standards, arguing that Obama exceeded Supreme Court precedent and encouraged racial bias in admissions. Democrats predictably attacked the move as racist. It is yet another clear Trump administration attack on communities of color and the principle that every student deserves a high-quality education that allows them to thrive, said Nancy Pelosi. Representative Cedric L. Richmond, Democrat, Louisiana, the chairman of the Congressional Black Caucus, also condemned the race-neutral admission guidance. I continue to be disappointed that the president of this great country demonstrably cares so little for its non-white residents and their interests. Many others played the race card, and their statements are equally ridiculous. Black conservatives, however, praised Trump's actions. Dr. Carol M. Swain, a former professor at Vanderbilt University and Princeton University, and a member of the Project 21 Black Leadership Network, praise the action. I've always felt that acceptance to higher education should be merit-based and means-tested. I believe President Trump is wise to rescind the aggressive Obama-era affirmative action directive for the use of race in student admissions, she said. According to Dr. Swain, the Obama-era policy placed students in situations where they are doomed to fail, become embittered by rising debt, and frustrated with the mismatch between abilities and expectations. Horace Cooper, the co-chairman of Project 21, agreed. In the 21st century, we shouldn't be making race a basis for who gets into school and who doesn't, he said. The Obama administration pressured schools to do just that. Now President Trump is moving us away from that approach, back to the colorblind vision of Dr. Martin Luther King. Reversing Obama's 11th-hour gun grab. In the years following the 2012 Sandy Hook Elementary School shooting, the Obama administration began pushing for stricter gun control measures. In 2015, that push grew to include a ban on gun purchases for Social Security beneficiaries if they needed a representative to manage their pensions or disability payments. The government would integrate Social Security Administration data into the National Instant Criminal Background Check System, NICS. This ban was called the largest gun grab in American history by the NRA, and an egregious case of bureaucratic overreach. The Social Security Administration finalized the rules a few short weeks before Obama left office. The policy was short-lived, as President Trump signed a bill on February 28, 2017, reversing the regulation. Naturally, the media aggressively pushed the narrative that Trump and the GOP had repealed background checks and were allowing the mentally ill to have guns. This was completely false. For starters, NICS is still in place. Charles C.W. Cook, the editor of National Review, explained that the Obama rule would have allowed bureaucrats within one of our federal agencies to bar American citizens from exercising a constitutional right, and on the highly questionable grounds that to be incapable of managing one's finances is by definition to be a mental defective. Even the American Civil Liberties Union, ACLU, opposed the Obama gun grab, saying, "There is no data to support a connection between the need for a representative payee to manage one's Social Security disability benefits and a propensity toward gun violence." Paul Applebaum, a leading expert on legal and ethical issues in medicine and psychiatry, said the Obama rule was fundamentally not a rational policy, and that people targeted by the rule are not a particularly high-risk group for violent behavior. Gun violence researcher Jeffrey Swanson said the NRA's position was in the right. "This is one of those times where the progressive politics du jour and the science, and I think the legal analysis, diverge." Allowing states to deny Planned Parenthood funding. Abortion isn't just a sacred cow for the radical left, it's big business for their allies. Planned Parenthood is America's largest abortion provider, and they received millions in taxpayer dollars, ostensibly to subsidize female reproductive health care. In turn, Planned Parenthood donated heavily to the Democratic Party. Months before Obama left office, his administration proposed regulations to prevent states awarded federal family planning funds under Title X from withholding those funds from clinics that provide abortions. Even though the regulation never mentioned Planned Parenthood, he obviously wrote it with them in mind. At the time, Obama assumed Hillary Clinton would be his successor, but America had other plans. When Trump was elected, the Obama administration rushed to finalize the regulations, which they did in mid-December 2016. The new rules took effect 2 days before Trump's inauguration. Trump promised to defund Planned Parenthood on the campaign trail, and as a first step, he signed House Joint Resolution 43, effectively rescinding the Obama regulation on April 13, 2017. Marjorie Dannenfelser, the president of the Susan B. Anthony List, a pro-life women's group, called the move a promise kept by Trump. This puts an end to the outgoing gift that Obama gave the Trump administration, which was to disallow states from being in charge of its own family planning funds. It isn't a full defunding yet, but thanks to Trump, states still have the freedom to deny Title X funding to clinics that provide abortions, including Planned Parenthood. Pro-worker, not pro-union. Barack Obama's relationship with unions goes back many years. In his book, The Audacity of Hope, Obama wrote, "I owe those unions. When their leaders call, I do my best to call them back right away. I don't consider this corrupting in any way." The influence of big labor on American politics is undeniable. They collect billions in union dues a year and spend a nice chunk of that backing politicians who support them, like Barack Obama and other leftist candidates. Their support has earned them influence. As President Obama owed a lot to his union supporters, he supported pro-union causes like card check and opposed anti-union causes like right-to-work laws. When the issue of compulsory union dues came before the Supreme Court in 2016, Obama's Justice Department sided with the unions. The Trump administration reversed that position, arguing that compulsory union dues violated workers' free speech rights. The Supreme Court ruled 5-4 in favor of the Trump administration's position, a major blow to public sector unions. A ruling 2 years earlier on a similar case resulted in a 4-4 split because of the empty seat left by Justice Scalia, so Justice Neil Gorsuch was seen as the deciding vote. The Trump administration also axed an Obama-era exemption to a federal law preventing states from skimming Medicaid subsidies paid to independent in-home care workers. The 2014 exemption created by the Obama administration allowed unions in 11 blue states to collect $200 million annually from health workers without them even being aware of it. Now let's talk about the National Labor Relations Board, NLRB. With a Trump-picked majority on the NLRB, Obama-era pro-union rulings were quickly reversed, restoring many pre-Obama precedents friendlier to workers than to partisan unions. Trump vowed to be an advocate for American workers, and he has successfully managed to dramatically shift labor laws in favor of hardworking Americans instead of powerful partisan labor union bosses. Reversing Obama's reinterpretation of Title VII. In 2014, the Obama administration reinterpreted Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which makes it unlawful for employers, including federal, state, and local governments, from discriminating against employees on the basis of sex, race, color, nationality, or religion. I have determined that the best reading of Title VII's prohibition of sex discrimination is that it encompasses discrimination based on gender identity, including transgender status, wrote Attorney General Eric Holder in a memo to Justice Department employees. Liberals have a very nebulous and broad interpretation of what constitutes discrimination. As Ryan T. Anderson, Ph.D., of the Heritage Foundation explains, according to liberals advocating such policies, discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation can be something as reasonable as an adoption agency preferring married moms and dads for orphans. And discrimination on the basis of gender identity can be something as simple as having a bathroom policy based on biological sex, not gender identity. The Obama administration had no constitutional authority to do this. They rewrote existing legislation by changing the meaning of the word sex, a biological reality, to gender identity. Congress couldn't possibly have intended this when they passed the Civil Rights Act. Transgenderism wasn't even a part of the public discourse in 1964. When the City Council of Charlotte, North Carolina, expanded their non-discrimination ordinance to include sexual orientation and gender identity, and allowed individuals to choose restrooms corresponding to their gender identity instead of their biological sex, the state legislature responded by passing House Bill 2, HB 2, which prevented local governments from allowing transgender people, or anyone else for that matter, from using bathrooms that don't correspond with their biological sex. Then-Governor Pat McCrory signed the bill. Obama's Attorney General Loretta Lynch accused McCrory of violating Title VII and Title IX of the Civil Rights Act and threatened to withhold millions in federal funding unless state officials confirmed that the state will not comply with or implement the law. The Trump administration reversed the Obama administration's unconstitutional reinterpretation of Title VII in October 2017. Attorney General Jeff Sessions explained in a memo to federal prosecutors that when Congress passed the law, the word sex meant biologically male or female, and the Obama-Holder policy exceeded its authority in expanding the law without the consent of Congress. Sessions elaborated that the change in policy should not be construed to condone mistreatment on the basis of gender identity or to express a policy view on whether Congress should amend Title VII or provide different or additional protections. He added, "The Justice Department must and will continue to affirm the dignity of all people, including transgender individuals." While Democrats and LGBT activists cried foul, the blame really rests with the Obama administration. The Department of Justice cannot expand the law beyond what Congress has provided, explained DOJ spokesman Devin O'Malley. Unfortunately, the last administration abandoned that fundamental principle, which necessitated today's action. Reversing Obama's transgender bathroom rules in schools. In 2016, the Obama administration issued guidance to public schools declaring that the Departments of Justice and Education would treat a student's gender identity as the student's sex for purposes of enforcing Title IX. Title IX is a law passed in 1972 prohibiting sex-based discrimination in education. Under this guidance, the Obama administration directed schools to allow students to participate in sex-segregated activities and access sex-segregated facilities consistent with their gender identity, or else they'd be in non-compliance with Title IX and lose federal funding. So, Obama told schools that students could use the bathrooms, locker rooms, dorm rooms, even hotel rooms for field trips of their choice. A biologically male student could simply claim he identified as a female, and the school would have to oblige or risk losing their federal funding. The brazen disrespect Obama and his allies showed for the dignity and privacy of women and young girls who objected to sharing bathrooms and changing facilities with biological males is galling. 11 states sued the Obama administration over its transgender bathroom policy. The lawsuit asked the federal district court in Wichita Falls, Texas, to block the federal government from implementing, applying, or enforcing the new rules, regulations, and guidance interpretations, and accused the Obama administration of conspiring to turn workplaces and educational settings across the country into laboratories for a massive social experiment, flouting the democratic process and running roughshod over common sense policies protecting children and basic privacy rights. U.S. District Judge Reed O'Connor agreed that the Obama administration exceeded its authority by redefining sex as gender identity and, in August 2016, temporarily blocked the policy from going into effect, leaving the status quo intact until the lawsuit worked its way through the courts. The Obama administration appealed this decision, and a Hillary Clinton administration would have continued to fight for it, but the Trump administration revoked the Obama transgender policy about a month after Trump took office, arguing that states and school districts, not the federal government, should make such policy decisions. Reversing Obama's campus sexual assault policy. Obama exceeded his authority to expand Title IX in other ways as well. In 2011, his Department of Education issued a Dear Colleague letter, which compelled colleges and universities to investigate any incidents of sexual harassment or sexual assault, whether they occurred on or off campus, and drastically lowered the standard of evidence in order to increase the likelihood of finding the accused guilty. Schools had to comply or risk losing funding under Title IX, all at the expense of due process for the accused. Essentially, the procedure there works under the assumption that the accused is guilty and needs to use the hearing to prove his innocence. K.C. Johnson, author of Until Proven Innocent, Political Correctness and the Shameful Injustice of the Duke LaCrosse Rape Case, explained to Fox News. But he isn't given the tools to do that. He doesn't have discovery, he can't get the relevant evidence he needs, he doesn't have an attorney representing him, and has limited right of cross-examination. So there's virtually no way, once an accusation is made and gets into the system, that the accused can be exonerated. In some cases, students were found to have been falsely accused after getting kicked off campus. For those students, one lie ruined their lives. Despite hundreds of lawsuits by male students who said they were falsely accused and denied due process, the Obama administration never wavered. They continued to pressure schools to hold kangaroo courts to address campus sexual assaults. Harvard law professor Janet Halley, in a 2015 essay in Harvard Law Review, was critical of the pressure on schools to hold students responsible for serious harm, even when, precisely when, there can be no certainty about who is to blame for it. Such calls are core to every witch hunt. Christina Hoff Summers, the author of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.